First off, I'd like to thank Gwen and the Ubique staff for inviting us. I apologize for my informal clothing. I just came from the airport after a delayed flight and 2 hours worth of Paris traffic. I thought Manhattan was bad, but getting into the city is much worse. It's always a pleasure to come to events like this to talk about what's happening in the digital landscape. Specifically, where we're going to focus this morning is really the approach to capturing new audiences. And it's a question that a lot of our clients, brands, as well as production companies that we're working with these days are really asking. And I think in light of what this conference is about, with the upcoming Cannes Lions also starting today, it's appropriate that we really focus in on how digital is shifting really the power to the audience and what that means moving forward for brands, production companies, distributors, and most importantly, each of us as consumers. So back in the 50s, little boxes being built, Ford and Chrysler in the driveway, and the family was gathered around the television set. One TV for every four people in the home. Today, a recent study has cited that there are 12 TVs or 12 screens for every four people in the home. And really what we're seeing is this shift into the personal screen. A lot of people are calling it the second screen. I truly believe that it is the first screen. It is that which is personal. Each of us probably have a tablet, if not a smartphone in our pocket today. And that screen is empowering the consumer and more importantly, shifting the environment to where we're seeing a trend back to the early days of television, that of branded content or sponsored content. The next video I'm gonna show you is a little take on a video that we pulled together, really showcasing the landscape and what we're all faced with in terms of the end of TV as we know it.
All right, it starts with the website, tweets and likes and app store. Zuckerberg is not afraid. I am a social game, let your DVD burn. Netflix serve its own needs, curate up your own needs. Feed it off a laptop, Skype, go stream. The Twitter starts to flatter with the beer bite down hype. Fire in the wire, regulating Robin Williams in an FCC for hire in a Tumblr site. Left and right in transmedia, hashtags bring me down your neck. Phone by phone, networks map uploaded, tethered hack. Look at that Facebook like Vine. Then, LOL, cat retro participation, get even, it'll do. Lean back, lean forward. Netflix serves its own needs, listen to your Sims bleed. Tell me with emoticons burning up my second screen. View systematic Facebook ad spam bite, overflight, feeling pretty white. It's the end of TV as we know it. It's the end of TV as we know it. It's the end of TV as we know it. And I feel fine. 8 o'clock streaming hour, don't get caught in cable powers. Crash and burn, return, listen to your open churn. Uploading sheen, waiting true blood time. Letting farm will make you propagate. YouTube user generate. Skip a nap, skip a soap, level up, level down. Watch attention die, die, uh-oh. This needs no base, cyberspace, four square, checking here, a tournament of HDMIs. Offering birds, offer me coupons, and I decline. It's the end of TV, yes, we know it. Demand suicide, Mountain View online, Al Gore's big lie. Lady Gaga, Ashton Kutcher, Rolling Girl, Larry Page, texting party, shitting cats, Google crash, boom. You systematic Facebook addicts, man, put neck, right? Right. It's the end of TV, yes, we know it. It's the end of TV, yes, we know it. It's the end of TV, yes, we know it.
So that's where we are. I don't know about you, but when I watch that, my head spins with what's going on out there in the marketplace. And really what we're seeing is a shift and a fundamental shift in the industry. I started my career back in Silicon Valley right after college, 1992, co-founding a magazine called The Red Herring. Followed the dot-com boom all the way up, inches away from taking a company public called the Hollywood Stock Exchange. Bear Stearns, the old Bear Stearns, left us at the altar, the bubble burst. And a lot of people said, we'll never see this again. And sure enough, we're going through bubble 2.0, if you want to look at it as a bubble. I firmly believe that what we're seeing is a shift in the media landscape, and really a shift, and technology will work one day, I promise, from a single screen environment to multi-screen experiences. It will be about multiple screens. It will no longer be a lean back world, but one that is very much lean in and on demand. The idea of 9 o'clock on Tuesday night, Friday at 5, okay, those days are over. The only thing that will be appointment based in our view will be news, sports, and live events. And consumers will pay a premium for those. As well as a clicker that works. Lean back versus lean forward, we touched on that. Linear storytelling versus non-linear storytelling. One of the biggest opportunities today for producers is looking at how to complement that act one, act two, act three story with branches to that story that can go to the second or the first screen, as well as through other media. And the more nonlinear and the more social content gets, the richer the experience and the more holistic that experience is over the course of time. So it's no longer about Monday to Monday when Mad Men comes on, but it is very much about a continuous story throughout. From personal entertainment to social media, Randy touched on that. Traditional channels to cross-channel distribution. I firmly believe, and as we get further into this presentation, I firmly believe that the channel strata as we know it, the end of TV as we know it, will break down completely. I believe the minute that Apple puts that computer in the living room and the electronic programming guide emerges, similar to the way that iTunes changed the way that albums are bought and shifted us into a singles environment, the Apple TV and smart televisions from Samsung and others will shift us into an environment where NBC, CBS, and Fox as channels no longer exist. We will move to programming that we program, that we curate for ourselves, or that friends provide to us relative to our social media channels. Interruption versus invitation. This is really a shift in the way in which brands engage the consumer. No longer interrupt us with 30-second or 60-second spots, but consumers will invite that brand into their life based on brand loyalty. Nike will have permission, as you saw with the Nike Plus, with what they're doing with Apple and the shoe, or Nike with Connect, the recent announcement that was made relative to the personal trainer. The more utility that the brand is providing to the consumer through its products and complemented through technology, the more that brand will be invited into that consumer's life, providing greater loyalty over time. Defined formats versus dynamic environments. We're seeing a big shift away from traditional TV formats and very much into, like, Glass House in the United States on ABC, dynamic environments that are driven by consumers' participation. It will no longer just be about text 123 to vote for your favorite American Idol singer, but much more about the consumer being engaged in the content in real time. From one-way communication to open dialogues, which we're seeing through social TV. From disposable media to distributed content. Now, what do I mean by this? 30 seconds of time, a brand buys that time from a network. The audience that tunes in is the audience I capture, and then it is disposed of. Whereas content and brands investing in content, and I have two examples to show you in a minute, is very much distributable and is an asset long-term for the brand, which gets us into that earned media and social media value that you hear a lot of brands and agencies talking about today. From ad campaigns to transmedia programming, and from mass audiences to targeted communities. I promise you this chart normally does not take this long to get through. So the new brandscape, what are we seeing out there right now? Well, there's three boats on the water. One is the consumer, who is highly connected. One is the brand, who since the early days of radio has been telling their story. And the third is that of content, which is being highly socialized. As all three of these things are coming together in a unique environment, what we're seeing created by brands is dynamic storytelling. And that is what is at the heart of this branded content initiative in the marketplace right now. So what does content do? One, it targets the right consumers in their most receptive state. Two, it contextualizes the brand's messaging to reach the consumer in a way that is current, culturally relevant, and entertaining. And lastly, it empowers consumers to share the story across their network and create their own content around it. Content is the context in which brands will live in today's culture. Okay, and it's very important to understand that because it is no longer about product placement. Even though a computer or a car or a beverage may be relevant to the audience that you're trying to capture, if there is no context to that product and it being authentic in the story, the consumer will reject it and it will diminish the value of that brand, not enhance it. It's something that must be kept in mind in terms of developing these programs. So here's two programs that we've recently created for our clients. The first is out of our Paris office. It was done for Coke Zero. And the second is for DuPont, done out of our New York office in partnership with the BBC. Two very different programs, getting at the heart of what the brands represent and who the brand is trying to reach. And it is very much informed and infused by the brand's position.
Like a lot of kids from where I grew up, I had a pretty messed up childhood. A lot of drugs, gangs, all trying to hold you down. Then on a random day, me and one of my friends ended up in this dance battle. And that's when it clicked. That's when I knew what I wanted to do with my life, and that's when I really found dance. Or, I guess it found me.
Dance has progressed. It is insane what dance is right now. Dance has never had a better friend than technology.
We want to create the ultimate dance that everybody wants to do, that everybody does. I know it sounds crazy, but we really believe that one person can make a huge difference in the world.
We're going to learn the Captain Crease.
That's what's called the hammer roll.
Funky walking.
Brush to death.
The hip check.
Life as shooting star.
I'm Joey, aka Knucklehead.
When I met Joey, he was homeless. So he had to sleep in his car, sleeping in booths at a diner. And Joey was a good kid, he just needed direction.
I made up a dance called the Toe Tapping. You gotta check it out, it's super tight.
I think it's because it's like a victory dance. When something good happens in your life, you hit the toe tapping. When you win a battle, toe tapping. You hit the lottery, toe tapping. It's a way to celebrate no matter what's going on. Good or bad, just keeps you going, keeps you smiling through it all.
Definitely impressed.
Yeah, I like that.
Great job.
Get your toe tapping on.
And suddenly, our little dance started catching on. Just got bigger and bigger.
on is pretty spectacular.
I think you'll be amazed, that's for sure, about it.
I mean, that is so captivating.
You guys are giving inspiration to young kids all over the world.
Germany, Totapi.
Totapi.
It's going global. There's no stopping it.
Everywhere to pursue their dreams.
I always thought it could be big. But I never imagined it could be this big.
So informed by the brand's position, Make It Possible, and the social movement or context of dance, these things were infused by the Paris office here creatively to create a platform and a call to action for people, as you saw, to send in their dance moves. And in working with John Chu and the League of Extraordinary Dancers and the phenomenon that had been unleashed by John with that program, what we're able to do is, in essence, elevate this entire campaign to the point that, as you saw, it went entirely viral on a global basis and really has created an entertainment property for Coca-Cola. In light of time and me being overtime here, we're going to jump over the DuPont case, leave you with a couple quick crystal ball predictions here.
In 2011, the Earth's population
surpassed 7 billion. So what are we going to see, aside from remotes that work? Not much. First off, traditional media model will no longer exist. I don't believe we're going to live in a world of CPM alone. There'll be a pricing model built on audience engagement. The data is there. I heard Randy talk a little bit about data. Data is critical. We can understand how people engage. There are different levels of engagement from email to post. I don't necessarily know that a like is activism. It's more like a slacktivist saying that they like something. Okay, that is a low level of engagement. But as social gets more rooted in content, you will see a new pricing model that emerges. A model that actually, in our view, is going to be blended from cost per impression to cost per click to cost per view to cost per lead to cost per acquisition. All of those things are critical to a brand's program and should work together in an entire model. Premium content is going to get pushed to branded applications residing across all personalized consumer screens. For those of you that live the Web 1.0 world, we're going to go back to a world of pointcast where content is pushed at us based on what we like and more preferences or data that the app understands about us. We're also going to see the rise of what we're calling micro-content. Somebody asked a question about how to monetize content. Discovery, Nat Geo, CNN, Canal Plus, sitting on huge archives in the cloud of content. As somebody is watching something linearly on King Tut, they may want information about Leakey's diary that's sitting somewhere in a database. Somebody's willing to pay for that. It may be 50 cents, it may be a dollar, it may be an open auction market, similar to what Facebook's doing right now with their ad market, okay? But that content will be meta tagged and will be available. And again, producers need to be thinking about how that content can in essence be applied and embedded within the video and accessible to consumers at a minimal cost. So David once said, what really decides consumers to buy or not to buy is the content of your advertising, not its form. And I think what you're gonna see is different forms of content and advertising blending together to create a new experience for the consumer moving forward. And with that, I leave you. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
That's great.
One question, Doug, one single question.
Sure.
And if there's questions out there, let me know, but we're gonna keep moving ahead. Advertisers just haven't made the connection with video. Just not making, you know, what Randy was talking about, the same sort of thing. You are one of the biggest advertising agencies in the world. What's this online video? Why are so many people watching online video and there isn't, no one's making really any money from it yet?
Well, I think that the challenge that we all face is the approach to video in a traditional sense. So what emerged from the media side, from the distributors of that content, was pre-roll, mid-roll, post-roll.
Right.
And similar to that of the interruptive approach of traditional advertising, I think that in a very short period of time in the early days of video, we saw that the pre-roll, mid-roll, post-roll is not going to work for an advertiser. And more advertisers...
Why not?
What was that?
Why is it not working?
Well, I don't think consumers want that. If consumers are going to invite that content to be distributed to their tablet or to their other device, and for that matter, are probably paying for it either through iTunes or paying for it through their cable operator or through Netflix, the last thing that they want is an ad on top of it. So what you're seeing is more and more advertisers create content. And I think that that trend will emerge even more so, as well as the rise of free content underwritten by brands, which is commercial free.
Great. One question out here. Anyone? Fantastic. Thank you very much, Doug Scott from Ogilvy.